What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Iconic Conversations, a countercultural podcast that brings together innovators, community builders, and world changers for authentic dialogue on the human experience, sparking curiosity, vulnerability, and empathetic connection to the world. Today, I have a guest, an entrepreneur, founder, a guy who's actually a community builder. The definition of a community builder is somebody who is out there. We met when I came to Austin, more specifically at this party, this Web3 party. And ever since then, we saw each other here and there, but a genuine soul. And it's such a pleasure and honor to be able to have Mr. Michael Marra, CEO and founder of Entre, on the show today. Welcome, bro.
Appreciate it. Glad to be here, man. This is, this is going to be exciting.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Of course, I gave my intro, but give a little bit of an intro about yourself, your name, your hometown, and I don't want to say occupation because usually people already do that. So what is something that you've been enjoying lately?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Michael Marra, we actually don't even really know the correct pronunciation of my last name. It's Italian. So it's we say Marra, but a lot of people say Marra and stuff too. But I grew up in Pittsburgh, born and raised there. And then went on kind of this crazy journey of entrepreneurship over like last pretty much probably 8 years now. Yeah, it's crazy. So I used to be a civil engineer. Like that's what I went to school for and everything. And then I left my job in like 2015 and got kind of just like down this whole path of, building companies and connecting people, doing events. And now over the last 4 years, it's been mainly just like building a tech company. That's been my main focus in building Entre.
Yeah, yeah. All right, let's talk about this. All right, so 2015, 8 years ago, you're 30, right?
Or 31? I just turned 32, bro.
You just turned 32, but yeah, you don't look 32, man. That's
so
man.
Cool. I know. I got good genes.
Not good genes. So, what was 20-year-old Michael like? That's like sophomore year of college. What was your day to day? How are you living? Did you go to college?
Yeah. I went to the University of Dayton in Ohio. Okay. It's like, kind of close to Pittsburgh. I wanted to like get away, but not like super far, you know what I mean? And just like make new friends, like be out of Pittsburgh a little bit.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, it was like, I don't know if I would even enjoy hanging out with my 20-year-old self now. You know what I mean?
Really?
Like, well, it's not that I wouldn't. It's just, we're on totally different pages, right? Like back then my focus was, obviously in school taking classes, like my course load was rough. Like any engineer, like college is like, pretty tough, but I was also trying to enjoy college. I was trying to have fun. I was, going to parties. I was, chasing girls, the normal stuff, you know what I mean? And that was, I would say that was probably even more of a priority for me than school and classes and all that stuff. Like I almost failed out after my sophomore year. Wow. Like I was close because the courses were just brutal, man. It was like, it's like Calc 2, Physics 2, you're getting into all the engineering courses and it's just a different, like if you're not studying, like you have to almost study every day and it's, I wasn't taking it like super seriously. So then after that, I was like, okay, because they try to weed people out. They want you to almost like switch majors if you're not really into it. So it was like, I had that conversation of like, okay, do I switch to business? Do I really want to do engineering and all of this stuff? And so that was 20-year-old, that was 20, 21-year-old Michael.
Dang. I mean, no, I think that's relatable because again, like I feel like anybody, you just follow the crowd. And so that was like what?
Yeah, exactly.
So that was like 12 years ago. 12 years ago, we're in 2023. So that was 2011.
Yeah. Yeah. I graduated high school 2010, which is wild. And then college.
That's an ancient sixth grade, bro.
Yeah, dude. Yeah, man. It's wild. There's like, I have so many friends now. They're like born in 2000, whatever. And I'm like, what, or like late 90s, and I'm like, bro, like I was literally like in middle school when you were born.
Yeah, bro, like that is so insane. That is so, yeah. But then like But I guess because, like, you know, you've seen it, because I get it, but I feel like you're in a really good sweet spot, like, because you are able to connect with the 40, 50-year-old, but you still, and because you're very young, you're very fit, and of course, you know, the energy around Austin, all that stuff is still young too, like people my age, 24, and even younger. And you're in this in-between where you get the Gen Xer mentality from your parents, whatever. You're a millennial, but then also, like, you've seen Gen Z and you've seen all the other ones come up. So I guess, you know, as building a product, you know, what have those insights provided for you in order to make you a better entrepreneur, business leader?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I think I try to be adaptable and I try to be almost like a chameleon with my surroundings and my environment and who I'm talking to. So, like, I can have great conversations with 50-year-olds, 60-year-olds, 40-year-olds, whatever. And I can have also great conversations with younger people and figure out how to relate to them as well. I think in any product, anytime, especially a consumer product, you have to understand the younger audience. You also have to understand, especially like for marketing purposes, which, and nowadays distribution is so important, you have to understand what is cool, what is trending, how do I relate to the younger audience, how do I relate to Gen Z, and even younger now, these kids that are turning 18 and stuff. So it's getting to the point where if you're not understanding that stuff, then all of those, you're going to get replaced as a brand. So for us, we're trying to really set the new precedent for how a professional network should look in the modern world, right? And relate more to the younger audience through entrepreneurship and communities and events, and versus what is, you know, the big, you know, incumbent in the space with LinkedIn. It's very old school. It's very corporate. The younger audience doesn't really vibe with them. So for us, it's like positioning ourselves to be that for this next generation. And that's really important to us.
Oh, that's fire. That's fire. And I like that because, again, you know, we see LinkedIn and some other places, but the thing is what you said that was key was a brand. And I don't know, like, you've been building Entre for about what, 8 years now, right? No, four.
So it's tricky because I started doing events and building out this entrepreneur community in really like 2016, 2017. But it was really just like, I didn't even know what it really was at that point.
Right.
And then the first company that I set up was called Me Group, which was a millennial entrepreneur group. And then that's what I started doing events around. And I had a Facebook page, a Facebook group, and an Instagram page. And I was just doing that, and then events at co-working spaces, and then basically just evolved and grew into this thing. And I wanted to build an app, but the tools that were available, it just didn't make sense. So then it was like, okay, now we need to build a custom app. It's like, okay, now how do I raise money? Like, how do I build an app? I'm not technical, so I have no idea. So then that started that whole journey. And then in 2019, we really like established it as a, you know, new Delaware C Corp. I still have my LLC, but this was like, okay, let's be like a real tech company here. You know, let's take that next step.
Man, the thing is, it's a big step. The fact that, you know, cause I feel like the most people see on the Instagram this is talking from my perspective. When I was about 19, 20, I used to follow all these guys on Instagram, Prince Donnell, and all these entrepreneurs. And they always talked about LLC, LLC, LLC.
Yep.
But then now when you start getting into the venture world and like real business, it's that C Corp. Like, that's when it's legit.
Of course. Yeah.
So obviously there's the fact of putting it and putting in the paperwork, right? But what was the mindset for you? Like, how did you feel like your mindset had evolved for you in order to say from being an LLC to like C Corp, talk about that mind shift in order for you to be able to make that jump.
For sure. I mean, like I tell people a startup in a tech company is a totally different game than a like online business, small business and all of that, right? in most cases, if you're just doing a normal business, you have a product, you're doing a small business, you have a store, you're doing consulting, coaching, whatever, online business, anything else, generally, you're going to probably do an LLC. If you're trying to build, and then there's its own challenges and different things for that. If you're trying to build a tech company and a startup, that is a whole different ballgame. That is like, you know, playing like small businesses, like playing table tennis. And then this is like real tennis, like on a court with different rules and a different ball and different players and bigger, like it's so different. And when you get into that game, you have to understand how that game works. Mm. And that game works with Delaware C Corps. That game works with, you know, raising from angel investors, raising money from venture capitalists. In most cases, like, it's very rare if you're building a tech company to not raise capital. So, you know, obviously there's different levels to that, but you have to build product, you have to build team, right? You have to do all of these other things that, like, yes, you need a team and marketing stuff with a small business, but it's at such a bigger scale with a tech company, and you're trying to figure out how to go from zero to $1 billion with a tech company versus a small business or an online business. In most cases, you're trying to go from zero to like $1 million and you're happy with that. Right. Yeah. And that's the vast majority of people. So it's like, how do you basically 1000X like that? And that's what building a tech company is. So it's like, it's just a different, it's a whole different ball game. And I didn't realize that when I was first starting out. And I didn't know anyone that was like in that game really. So I had to figure it out a lot myself. And it took me a lot longer than most people. Or if someone was asking me like now, I can tell them how to do it way faster than I did. You know what
right.
I mean?
Right. And it reminds me of the LinkedIn post. Right, that you posted about, like, I think a couple of weeks ago. And it's just like the number one key thing in business is staying alive.
Yeah.
Talk about that. Like, what got through your head to say, to post that and say, yo, just stay alive?
I'm almost positive I got it from David Meltzer. So, and it's like, the point of business is to be in business, right? And the goal is to stay in business. So, and that means being self-sufficient in most cases. Most tech companies, I wouldn't even consider them necessarily businesses because most of them don't make real money and they don't have real business models and stuff. And I'm not saying that like in a negative way. That's just the reality of what startups are and tech companies are, because the game is very different and the risks and the rewards are so high in that game. Versus if you're doing a small business, you have an LLC, whatever, you have to think about how am I making money right away? Like, that is that game. With tech companies and stuff, you don't necessarily have to think about making money right away. You can raise capital and then leverage that capital to invest in the team and build the product and then grow revenues to the point where hopefully you're close to breaking even and whatnot now. Right. And that's kind of where we're at, honestly. Like, we're at the point where we're like, we want to control our own destiny. We want to get to the point where we're like, hey, we're making money. Like, we can keep growing this the way that we are. Yes, we want capital to scale faster, but we don't need it, right? And I think that's positioning is very powerful for a lot of entrepreneurs and especially startups and tech companies. But yeah, man, I think a lot of people like lose sight of what a business like is really by definition. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's facts. And so now that's a really, really good point. Somebody is going to get revelation today about the difference between a little like doing a startup and doing an LLC. And I think like the fact that, you know, it's okay, like, because this TMG, this is a lifestyle business. I after doing the startup thing, I realized I don't want to be a startup CEO. I do not envy the startup CEO. I like my lifestyle business where, you know, being able to throw events, being able to like have the opportunity to control the schedule, have merch. It's like, I'm not necessarily needing it to survive. Because you need to have the self-awareness of like, are you willing to stick to one thing for 7 to 10, even 12 years. Okay, that's after you get VC, but what were you doing before this to make sure this vision comes into reality? And most people don't realize that.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head, man. I tell people all the time, it's like, that's the best place to start from right there. It's understanding yourself, like being self-aware of like, what's the end game that you really want? Like, because most people don't understand what the end game of a CEO is. It's like, you're dealing with people, problems, investors. Like in most cases, startup CEOs don't even control the majority of their company. They can get fired from their own company, right? And you have a board of other people who can control your decisions. So there's a lot of different variables that people, the idea of being Elon Musk or a tech CEO is like awesome. But if the lifestyle that you want is, hey, I want to have passive income. I want to be able to work from wherever. I don't want to have to answer to a bunch of people. I want to be my own boss and I want to control everything. And yeah, I want to work with some great people and stuff, but I really want to have more control. Then you should not do a tech startup, right? Like you should figure out how to do e-com, coaching, consulting, SaaS, like whatever. Do you know what I mean? Instead, because that is not the reality of what, you know, a tech CEO is for the most part.
Right. I like that. And, you know, this is actually a good segue because I had a previous question I was going to ask, but now that you talked about this. So talking about, you know, we talk about building business, but what is how are you building the business of Michael? You know, like, and what has that process look like? And what is your end game?
are you saying more like personally than,
personally.
Yeah, I mean, so... You know, I think the biggest thing over the last like few years for me has been refining my like more of my schedule, my routine and my lifestyle, right? It's like, okay, like and making sure that, yeah, things are a little bit unbalanced, right, for me because I do work a lot and like that is my work right now for me is still my top priority.
Right.
I don't have a family, like all of that stuff. I don't have to worry about that. And, yeah, I want that at some point in my life, but when I do, I want to like be able to focus on that as like my top priority. Right now for me, like work is top priority. Underneath that is probably like health, wellness, and all of that, right? And making sure that that's on point because that's also very important to be a high performer, you know, as a CEO and whatnot. So I'm looking to get better from that standpoint as a leader, as a CEO, right? As an entrepreneur. And really refining, I think the habits, routines, and all of that. Like when I was first starting out, my schedule was so messed up, man. I was working like so late and then getting up late. It was just all out of whack. You know what I mean? And making sure that like you're prioritizing that also is really important. So now like, this is probably the best, I would say like routine schedule wise, like sleep schedule, work schedule that I've had. Right. Mm-hmm. And it's balanced enough where I still like will play tennis or pickleball at night or mornings and work out. And most of the time for me right now, it's like 9 to 9 or 9 to 8, whatever is like my work window, Monday through Friday. That's like when I'm getting shit done. You know what I mean? And I know that like, as long as I'm doing that, like I'm going to be good. Like I don't need to overwork myself more than that. Yeah. On the weekends and stuff, catching up with things here and there. And if something needs to get done, great. But I think, you know, having the ability to turn it off a little bit too is helpful, right? Getting outside, being around other people. So that's also what I've been trying to just refine. It's like what works for me as Michael, right? It might be different for you and for everyone else. So it's like figure out what routines, habits can let you perform at a high level at whatever it is, whether it's work or, you know, job or your business and whatnot, but making sure that you're able to perform at a high level, but also remain, you know, healthy, happy and all of that stuff. Cause at the end of the day, man, you don't want to be building a company unhappy. It's not fun.
Yeah. At any point, were you building the company unhappy?
Oh, yeah. I mean, dude, there was, I mean, years, bro. Like, yeah. I mean, the first, like, from probably, I mean, dude, right after I left my job, it was like, I was making pretty much no money. Like, it was, I was like, oh, dude, I'll figure this out so easy. Like, no problem. Right. And I first got into real estate. So that was like the first, I wanted to like be an investor, basically. That was like what I initially left my job for.
To be an investor.
In stocks. I had like a mentor in stocks and I had a mentor in real estate. And I basically went down the real estate path, ended up moving to Miami, started a real estate company with one of my mentors there. So I spent like over a year in Miami, basically doing like wholesaling, Airbnb rentals, all of that stuff. So I learned that whole game, which was cool, but it just wasn't it. And it was like, I was working like crazy and I was not making much money at all. So it was like, you know what I mean? And then I come back to Pittsburgh and start doing my own thing. Cause I wanted to build this community for entrepreneurs. And dude, I was working by myself every day till like probably like 4 a.m. Like, and then I would get up at like noon. So that was like, I did that for probably a year.
Whoa.
And then I started traveling. So it was like working solo, right? Like late nights, it just was not healthy at all. So, yeah. And then like you break out of that, like you grind through it. And it was like, there was a part of me that thought that I had to do that in a sense, right?
Don't you think it's because of like the media that was out there, all that stuff and everything like that? It was just like, you know, like Gary Vee hustled hard.
Yeah, no, 100%. I mean, there's part of that, right? Where you're like, okay, once you realize that entrepreneurship's hard, you're like, okay, I need to grind. I need to do this. And the reality is it's like, you really don't need to you don't need to make it harder than it should be. Right. And like, you know, like you think that you need to like make it difficult in a sense. But it's, yeah, you don't have to, right. You really don't. Like there's ways of doing it that you don't need to like get yourself super stressed and whatnot. Like looking back on it, like I wish I would have just stayed at my job longer. Right. Or found a job that was a little bit less maybe demanding or whatever, but my job was pretty chill, right? I wish I would have just stayed at my job longer or joined a startup, right? As like on the product team or whatever else. Like I tell people all the time, if you want to get into tech and you're not in tech right now, you need to get into tech first before you start a tech company. Like I started a tech company and an app trying to take on LinkedIn, not ever working in tech or ever built an app before. That's insane.
That's the definition. But see, it's that delusion, right? Because most first time entrepreneur, not even first time, but like it is that delusion that is necessary, though, in order to have that guts to say, yeah, I can do this. Because imagine that's why I feel like a lot of people who do work inside tech, it takes them a lot longer for them in order to make the step because they know like, ooh, this is going to be hard. Yeah. But like, and that's why they don't do it. Right. But you're doing it, but you did it, right? Like I'd same for me. I wanted to make a media company.
Right.
I never worked in a media company. And I don't know what I'm going to do, but let's just figure it out.
Right. And there is a part of that that is what makes entrepreneurship so like, that is like what makes entrepreneurship, right? It's like you have to almost not, you have to not care. You have to have like, you have to take risks. You have to have some balls like to just do it and just like be okay with figuring it out along the way. Like there is a part of that that makes entrepreneurship like really, really just like it's daring, but at the same time, it makes it what it is. Like that's why entrepreneurship is, it's difficult, but so rewarding when you can like look back and be like, damn, I did like actually do that with like not knowing what was going to happen at all.
Yeah. Oh no, that is so dope. And just now having that philosophy and that mindset, that's really, really good. What do you feel like is your differentiating factor? You know, people always say, like, you know, I bet you hear this, but a bunch from like investors about your product. But what is Michael's value differentiator that makes you like valuable in any space? Have you ever thought about that?
Like me personally?
Yeah, like you personally.
I mean, I think it's a lot of the stuff that we were talking about. Like, I'll jump into whatever, right? And I have like a wide variety of skill sets. So like, I have my hands in like everything, in a sense. Do you know what I mean? Like, and there's good things about that, and there's bad things about that. I think you know, I think it's good to be specialized, right? And to be like really, really, really good at one thing or a couple of things, right? I think that's good. I think, but for like founders and CEOs, I think it's good to have an understanding of a lot of different departments and a lot of different things, because then you can plug into whatever, and then you can be, you can have conversations with every team at a high level and make decisions for each team, or at least a few teams or several teams. And make important decisions because you do understand those things at a high level. So like, I can plug into marketing, content, product, UX. Like, I can't really do too much on the development side, right? But you know, I don't, like, from a technical perspective, like, I understand the things that are happening. You know what I mean? But for me, it's like, as I understand product and design, I think, and that's like the user experience, I think, is more important than understanding the technical side, right? Yeah. And then marketing, distribution, all of those things, understanding finances, raising capital, certain things. So I think that, I've had a lot of like experience in everything, right? Which is good. I think as a founder, I think it's bad if you're working on a team. I think you want to like specialize in something for the most part, but you know, obviously there's different ways of doing it. I think if you have co-founders and stuff, it makes it easier. One person can specialize on tech. One person can specialize on fundraising. One person can specialize on product. One person can specialize on marketing. Right. I think that's the ideal scenario. I think for most founders, in most cases, you kind of have to have a mix of everything. But yeah, that's what I would say. Like, my strength is being able to like plug in to different parts of the company and speak on a high level and everything.
Yeah, that's good. That is the classic definition of what it means to be a CEO. Like being able to move like a CEO, like a real CEO. What is your, honestly, let's keep it real. What is your least favorite aspect of being an entrepreneur?
Yeah, I mean, it's tricky. I mean, I think obviously the difficult conversations suck, right? It's like, you know, and obviously there's a lot of pressure and stress. Like, dude, there's days where I'm like, bro, like, there's so much shit going on. It's like you're putting out fires. You're trying to like hire people, you have to fire people. There's a million things that can be happening, right? And that has to be totally aside from your personal life too. So like, there can be stuff happening in your personal life, you know, and you have to put that aside. Like, I mean, I haven't had like a vacation, I don't, you know, and since I left my job, pretty much, like, really, like, a true vacation. I probably haven't had, like, a real, like, I'll go on trips and, like, I'm with family and stuff, but,
like, you work, still
doing stuff. Like, it's not, like, I literally don't have my laptop or phone with me, or, like, I'm literally just chilling. You know, which I don't mind, because my mind goes that to that anyway, like, without me even trying to do it.
Right.
And, you know, I'm fine with that, because I do like it. I'm like obsessed with this, right? And I think that that's important. You know what I mean? But I think obviously there's a ton of pressure, stress, like all these things. But you know, you have to understand that getting into it. I think that's the most important thing. Again, kind of going back to the conversation we had earlier, it's like you really should understand what all it's going to take and the lifestyle and stuff. So like, you know, you have to, if you're not set up for that, if you don't want to do that, then like you should rethink things and just reassess like how you really want to live your day-to-day life.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel like you're living your dream?
I think that I'm, I wouldn't, I like, I don't know if I'm, I mean, I wouldn't say I'm living my dream right now. Like this is cool. Like I'm enjoying my life right now for sure. And this is like the best my life has ever been for sure.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But am I living like my dream life? No. Like I'm like, I, you know, there's a lot of things that I want. There's a lot of things that I want to do. You know, I love building stuff. Like I like this, like I like this. Right. Yeah. And I want to keep doing this, but there's other things that I want to do too. And there's like, you know, I think that, you know, between like where the lifestyle, the not necessarily the material things that I have now too, but it's like the access to stuff that like is out there, right? And the things that I've seen that are possible with more money or network and other things, it's like, wow, like that, I want that shit. You know what I mean? Like I want to be on that level. And then also just like family and stuff too. Like I want that as well. I think that that's like, I think that that's part of like the dream life that I want to get to. You know what I'm saying? I think that that's like, it'd be cool to have like, you know, family and little kids running around and like helping them achieve stuff too. So, yeah. And I think it changes. Like, I think your dream life should change. I think you should evolve. So it's just like, you know, I'm at a good place right now, but there's a lot more that I want for sure.
Yeah. Hey, I haven't really asked people that question on the pod, right? I mean, I'm in personal relationships. Like, yeah, I'm like, are you living your dream? Because people, yeah. Somebody asked me if I'm living my dream, and 90% yes, you know, which is way better than most, right?
Yeah.
And that's the privilege that we have, being in these spaces and moving the way that we do. But, you know, the fact that you were super honest, like, oh, there's still a couple things, like, because there is some high level, like, stuff, right? But, oh, yeah. Again, then the next question is, when is it, like, this is the question that, honestly, my ex asked me before she broke up with me. Well, we broke up with each other, but, you know, I was like, oh, yeah. It was a very reckoning. It's like, when will it be enough?
Yeah. And I mean, it's a great question. And it's one of those things where it's like, my goals and dreams and what I want, like, I'm always going to be desiring things. I think like, and I'm always going to want to not necessarily like improve, but I'm going to always want different things. Do you know what I mean? Like right now, like I'm trying to build massive wealth. Like I'm trying to get on another level. Do you know what I'm saying? Like
Billy yeah. Alert.
Like I'm in that phase of my life. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And you know, and it's not like I have a specific number. Like my number is whatever allows me to do all the stuff that I want to do whenever I want, with whoever I want, for as long as I want. And however much money I need to do that, then that's what I want. Do you know what I'm saying? So it's more like being totally financially free and independent without having to even think about what does that cost or what does this do, right? And obviously that's a lot of money, but is there a number? I don't really necessarily have a fixed number. Like I don't necessarily care. Obviously when you hit the $100 million, $1 billion status, that changes. You know, you get to that point. But, you know, I don't want to set up limitations for myself, right? Or, like, set something that if I don't get it, then I get mad about it. It's like, I don't really care. Do you know what I mean?
And then
after that point, it's like, well, then my focus is going to shift to my next generation, like my family, like building that. Right. Do you know what I mean? And then it's like helping them do that. And then it's like shifting to then just giving back to the world as a whole. It's like, let me build things that are going to last. Let me help, you know, just provide as much value as I possibly can for the future of humanity, right? Whatever that means. Yeah. And, you know, so I think there's stages to it. You know what I mean?
Yep, there's stages.
Yeah. So it's like, it's never enough. Like to the point, it's like, it's never enough, but it always changes. And I think, but at the same time, I'm content with like where I am.
Because again, like that's when you know you're a builder.
Right.
That's when you know that, that is when you know that you're building. Or you understand that I'm content with where I am right now, but I know that I can continue to go out there and continue to improve. Everything else will come as a byproduct of me, of this consistent, continuous improvement.
Yes.
Of just seeing where, how far I can go.
Yes.
Rather than saying, oh, I need to make the billy in order to feel like I've done it. I need to be able
exactly.
to do whatever in order to do
100%.
It. Because again, like your motivation, once you hit it, you know, your motivation, like that's where for most people depression sets. Right.
Exactly. And it's not, and yeah, and I think that's important to not treat it as like also like envious of like other people or like whatever. And I think it's like if you and if you don't get it, then like don't get hard on yourself. It's like just focus on today, focus on right now and what makes you happy and just like going towards that next thing that you do want. You know what I mean? And I think that that's like more of how I'm like looking at it. It's like, this is where I'm at. Here's like the next thing that I'm trying to get to. And I'm just taking steps each day to get to that point. And when that happens, or, you know, as I keep doing the stuff that I enjoy doing, then, you know, other things will come up over time.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That's actually like a really great way to go to segue to towards the ending. Like of the pod. So my last question would be, what's the challenge that you want to leave to the audience?
Yeah. Okay. Good question. So, I mean, I think, you know, I think I would love everyone to I wish everyone would try entrepreneurship. At the same time, it's not necessarily super accessible to everyone necessarily. I mean, you can literally throw open Shopify store. You can create content on social media, right? You can, I would like it's, you can pick something that is like such a low barrier to entry, right? If you create content on social media and you do well and you grow an audience, you can get brand deals. Like you can make money from just that and then just open up a personal LLC and you can literally start making a business from that, right? You can do a podcast as well. There's a lot of different options, right? You can do a Shopify store. You can create products. You don't even have to touch the products. If you just do like merch and stuff either, you can just use Printful and stuff. It's like, there's so many things. I encourage people to try, like I would encourage people to try something new, like just try something new. Like it doesn't necessarily even have to be entrepreneurship related. It could just be like pick jujitsu, tennis, like something, right? That is like putting you out of your comfort zone a little bit, right? That is new. That's going to work your learning brain. That's going to put you out of your comfort zone a little bit. And like, just try it. If you don't like it, try something else. You know, I think there was, I forget who said it, but there's like, you want to treat things as like, it's like a buffet, right? Most people never even go into the buffet line to try new stuff. But if you don't try stuff, you never know what you like. If you've never like tried ice cream, you don't know if you like it. And then if you do like it, do more of it. Get more on your plate. It's endless buffet, right? If you don't like it, go to the next thing. Try that. And if you like it, you can get more. But like keep trying stuff. Like I think that's such an important thing. And then you'll also pick up on things and just being aware of problems in the world. So if you like are interested in entrepreneurship, that's where everything stems. It's like you try things, you're like, this doesn't make any sense. That could be way better. This is like off. So that's the best way to start. But yeah, I mean that's what I would challenge everyone to do.
Beautiful. Well, man, thank you, Mike, for just the opportunity just to chop it up. Man, this is an enjoyable episode. Like,
yes, that was great.
I really enjoyed it. Where can the people find you at?
Yeah, I mean, socials is just Michael W. Marra on everything. And check me out on Entre, you know, joinentre.com. You know, you can DM me on there too and check it out. Interact with everyone else, join communities, check out some events. Got a lot of exciting things going on there.
That's beautiful. Just want to speak life over you, bro. You're incredible. It's not standout guy, stand up guy, and super grateful just to be able to share this time with each other.
Likewise, bro. This was great, man. Yeah, keep doing your thing, bro. You got a good thing going for sure.
All right. All right, y'all. Check us out. Check Mike out at Entre, and we are.